Welcome you to worship at Church of the Good Shepherd in Oswego, Illinois. So glad that you could join us for our online worship. And we hope that this will be a time where you can sense God's presence with you wherever it is that you are able to worship from. And knowing that we are together as a community of faith, even from our separate places. I want to lift up a scripture. As a way to focus us and kind of help us with the transition from whatever our activities were before worship has begun. And these are the two great commandments as Jesus explains them. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Let us worship.
Rejoice in the Lord, you righteous. Is it good for the just to sing praises? For the word of the Lord is right, and all of God's works are sure. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all who dwell in the world stand in awe of God. Happy is the nation whose God is the Lord. Happy are the people God has chosen to be God's own.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder come. consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior, guide to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior, guide to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think of God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to I scarce can take it in, that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior, guide to thee. How great thou art, how with shout of acclamation, and lead me home, with joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow with humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, how great thou art.
I was careless and inconsistent, caught up, I gave away my innocence. No one could tell me different, it was you got my attention. Our God is forgiveness. Our God of forgiveness. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank God, our God is forgiveness. Are you feeling lost, indifference, confused about what the truth is? You're invited to the Master's lesson. He'll give you the heart to listen. our God, is forgiveness. Our God, of forgiveness. Hallelujah, hallelujah, Thank God, our God is forgiveness. Is His mercy strong enough? Is His kindness strong enough? Blessed assurance, He's more than enough. Our God, our God is forgiveness. Our God, of forgiveness. Hallelujah, hallelujah,
like to talk to the boys and girls for a little bit. I just have a short story that I want to share. It's a fun little story, and it's about emotions. It's about being grumpy, actually. And there was a little boy once who had a nickname because he was grumpy so much of the time. But it's really a story about Thanksgiving. And we'll see how he learned about that. Are you ready? Grumpy. That's what Ashley called her brother, but his real name was Jason. He was just grumpy, it seems like, most of the time, even when other people were nice to him. When Ashley asked him to play a game, he would grump, "I don't feel like it." And when his friend wanted to ride bikes with him, Jason grumped, "I'd rather watch television." When mom said that she could bake some chocolate chip cookies, he grumped, "Oh, why don't you make something else?" Because he always sounded so grumpy, Jason made other people feel kind of grumpy too. "I don't want to play with you anyway," one of his friends said. "I'll ride my bike without you," another friend said to him. "I won't make cookies if you're going to complain about them," his mom said. So he played alone, no one to ride bikes with or make cookies with. Jason could hear his friends riding bikes outside. He could hear the others laughing and playing a game, including his sister. And Jason went outside and he sat down on the steps and he started to think about it and how he treated them. And he squeezed his eyes shut so that he wouldn't let his tears come out because he felt like crying. But then Jason remembered something important. He remembered that God could help him. So he used that moment to pray. And he prayed this way, "God, I'm sorry I've been so grumpy. Please help me to not be a grump today. Amen." Then he got up from the steps and Jason ran to his friends. He said, "Can I play with you? Please." And he was really nice to them. And they looked at him and they said, "Promise not to complain too much." He said, "I promise." Because he knew God would help him. Jason played with them for a long time. He didn't feel grumpy at all. Instead, he felt very happy. Later on, the door opened up and mom came out and she gave a big plate of chocolate chip cookies for him and his friends and everybody. And then they came out and they had lemonade. "Oh, thank you, everybody," Jason said. His mood was so much better now. Then he whispered, Thank you, God, as he gave just a little prayer, just soft enough so that God could hear. And I hope you liked that story about Grumpy, who really wasn't grumpy in the end at all, because he took it to God, and God helped him work through that. And I know that God can help you for any of your needs as well. So let's pray now. Dear Lord, you know that we sometimes get in a bad mood, and sometimes we're angry, sometimes we're sad, and it's hard to be in those situations. Sometimes we're just grumpy. But remind us that we can come to you and just open up our hearts and our minds and ask you to help us to find peace and joy once again. And we thank you that you care enough about us and all of our boys and girls that you can bring your peace to them. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, boys and girls, for listening to the story today. Well, as we lift up our joys and concerns to the Lord, I would like to begin by announcing the death of our brother in Christ, Bob Cully, this past week. Bob dealt with cancer for some time, and he did that with eyes wide open, but no fear of death. He was a strong man of faith. And he knew that if he was able to live longer, he would find joy in life and family and friends and church. And if he did not survive the cancer, he knew that he would be with his loved ones in heaven in the presence of the Lord. Bob Cully was a member and a regular worshiper at Church of the Good Shepherd. He was part of the car club that has met for years at our church as well. Bob was a Vietnam veteran and a very loyal member of the church and the community. Now, because of the COVID-19 restrictions, I will be leading a private service only for a small number of family. And in the meantime, let us remember in prayer his son, Mark Cully, and their family as they grieve the death of his father. We thank the Lord, though, for the life of Bob Cully, lived upon this earth and now with the Lord in heaven. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
All with the concern, of course, that's all around the nation in terms of the reactions to the death of George Floyd in Minneapolis, who was killed when he was being held by police. And there's a lot of feelings out there, very strong, of anger, of grief, of fear. And we've seen how that plays out in different ways among our communities. But I would like to, first of all, lift up the memory of George Floyd and those who personally knew him, as we pray for the Lord to give peace to them. And to know that George is in God's hands, in God's heavenly home. I want to lift up the protesters who have intentionally been peaceful in communities all across the country, who are reminding us that racial justice is so important for our communities to be healthy, for individuals to be respected. So that especially people of color do not have to live in fear of the police or of others treating them unfairly simply because of the color of their skin. So we lift up those protesters and we ask, Lord, that you would give them the strength that they need. And as speeches are made, may we all be educated to be more sensitive to racial justice, and to make sure that we do not stand idly aside in our silence and allow through that silence for injustice to continue. We pray, Lord, for all people of color who are in fear about violence or unfair treatment,
simply because of their race or the tone of their skin. We pray, Lord, also for people who are automatically privileged, perhaps because of their lighter skin, to understand that dynamic of white privilege, so that all of us can work for racial justice. Gracious Lord, you love all of your children, no matter what our race, our ethnicity, our language, our gender, our sexual orientation, where we live, our age. Lord, you love us all. And we affirm that today in our prayers as we lift up to you all those that we have named. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Well, this is a season where so many graduation ceremonies have not been able to take place as the traditions have been. But in our church, we wanted to make special mention of some graduates. There's a few relatives that we want to mention. Carol and Ed Bradley's granddaughter, Krista Halter, graduated from the University of Illinois with a degree in education. And Judy Burkhart's granddaughter, Mackenzie Burkhart, graduated from high school at Bainbridge Island, Washington, and will attend the University of Washington. And so we lift up Krista and Mackenzie and congratulate them on their achievement. And for some who are within our congregation, we want to give a prayer blanket that has been blessed by our prayer blanket ministry. And I want to start with this prayer blanket for Bryce Robinson. Beautiful blanket made by members of our United Methodist women. Thank you very much for doing that. Bryce graduated from Illinois Wesleyan University with a degree in marketing, and he is glad to already be starting his new job in downtown Chicago, working for Oracle. And so as we bless this blanket that we will be gifting to Bryce Robinson, we ask, Lord, that you would continue to watch over Bryce as he moves forward with his training, with his education, and gets established in his new work. We ask, Lord, that you would bless him in all the ways that is needed. As we lift up Bryce, we ask, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we have a prayer blanket also that I want to lift up. And this one is another wonderful one. This is for Lucas Ingram. And Lucas graduated from Oswego High School, and he is going to Aurora University, and he'll be majoring in accounting and finance and minoring in Spanish. But we lift up Lucas, and he'll be receiving this blanket from his church. And as we ask, Lord, for you to bless not only this blanket, but to bless Lucas himself, we ask that you would help him in his continued education this fall, and certainly for all the challenges of the coronavirus. May you help him and others find a way to continue their education. As we lift up Lucas, we ask, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we have one more prayer blanket that I want to bless, another one made by our prayer blanket ministry through the United Methodist Women, and this is for Nick Ports. And congratulations to Nick. He graduated from Aurora Christian High School, and Nick is looking forward to starting school this fall at Concordia University in Wisconsin. So as we lift up Nick for God's blessings, and we surround this blanket with our prayers. Lord, we ask that you would bless Nick in his continued education as he grows and matures, not only intellectually, but spiritually as well, and comes closer to you day by day. And so as we lift up Nick, we ask, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And there are some in our congregation who have birthdays this week. And so among them, we want to lift up and say happy birthday to Steve Lundy, Lisa Randazzo, Craig Watson, Gladys Odie. Happy birthday to Pamela Stutzman, Keith Wheeler, to John Church, to Joy Tierney, and happy birthday to Paul Schilling. So as we lift all these brothers and sisters with their special day coming up, we ask, Lord, that you would bless them and help them to know how loved they are by their church, by their family, and by you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us take some time now in silence to share those other prayers that you may still have upon your heart and listen for God's word to each of us this day. Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you for this day that you have created, that you have given to us as a gift. Lord, help us to find ways to share your love with one another, certainly as you have shared your love with us, so that we may love our neighbor as ourselves. Gracious Lord, we pray for your enlightenment for all of us as we learn better ways to live with one another in our neighborhoods, our communities, in our nation, so that we may not have lives that are wasted or hurt based on discrimination, bias, or hatred. For you love us all, and you call us to do the same. Gracious Lord, we ask for your continued help as we seek to stay safe from the coronavirus that has affected us in so many ways. And as many of our communities slowly open up, Lord, we pray that you would help us to be responsible, to stay safe not only for ourselves, but for others as well. And for those who continue to be those frontline workers who are helping those in need, we pray your blessings upon them, both in their work and in their rest as well. Gracious Lord, we lift up all these prayers to you, those that we have shared with you silently out of our hearts, as well as those that have been spoken aloud. And as we lift these up, we do so in the confidence of our faith, taught to us by Jesus, as we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join me in the prayer of praise and adoration. We do indeed stand in awe of you, O God. We rejoice that you have chosen us to be your own. By your word, the heavens were made. Your loving kindness fills the whole earth. By the bounty of your mercy, we have been born to new life. Hear now what fanfare we give you as our voices are lifted in praise of your name. Our readings today are from Psalm 51 and Hebrews chapter 8. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways so that sinners will turn back to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God. You are God, my Savior, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. This is the covenant I will establish with the people of Israel after that time, declares the Lord. I will put my laws in their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbor or say to one another, "Know the Lord," because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, for I will forgive their wickedness and will remember their sins no more. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, I'd like to share a few thoughts with you today related to some of the scriptures that you heard. And the title of my sermon is, What's the Score? Major League Baseball has not yet started. It's getting a little closer to reality, I hope. Opening day in July, if things go well, how does that sound? Very, very strange to me. I'm used to going to opening day when I've had to chip the ice off of my stadium seating before I can sit down because of snow and cold, wearing so many winter clothing layers that doesn't feel like baseball weather. That's what I'm used to for opening day, though. But opening day in July or whenever it happens is going to be so different from all of that, especially since most of us will just be watching on television and stadiums most likely will not be filled. But I still love the game, still love to read about it, play it on occasion, watch it. And anyone that follows baseball knows that a big part of baseball are the endless statistics that get generated. Records are kept on hits, runs batted in, stolen bases, earned run average, batting average, and so many other newer statistics that I don't really understand, to tell you the truth. For good or bad, every one of those statistics becomes part of the historical record, and it is never erased. It is never forgotten. But this is not only the territory of the professional statistician. It's a tradition that belongs to the average fan of baseball. Since I was 9 years old, I've been penciling in statistics to a scorecard of games that I've actually been to. And I actually track it all, whether they play poorly or well, whether my team lost or won. It's just part of the tradition for me, just part of the fun. And I know not everybody keeps scorecards, but many of us certainly keep score in other areas of our lives, not just with games. We may not keep track of the score of baseball games, but so often we do keep score in our relationships, be they at work or at home, or even our relationship with God. In our work, we may keep track of the score of successful projects that we have completed. Revenue that we've generated, we may keep track of the points that we've accrued so we can feel good about it. And certainly, our employers use some of this information to evaluate our work, but we also keep track, just again, to feel good about our contributions, about our work ethic, or just to feel good about what we're doing. It also comes in handy to be aware of when it's time to negotiate a new contract or to ask for special benefits or maybe even a promotion. But what about keeping score in a marriage? That happens quite frequently. A marriage does not require the kind of record keeping that our jobs might require, but in some ways we are just as intent on keeping score in that relationship. We may keep track of the chores that we do and the acts of kindness that we offer. But it's not always to feel good about our healthy contributions to a marriage. Sometimes our scorekeeping is simply a way to seek power, to evaluate self or to put down the other so that we can win the next argument. When we let competitive feelings into our marriage, it should send up a red flag right away. Something's not right here when that happens. Unconditional love is being threatened here when we're scorekeeping. Now, individual scorecards get used in friendships as well. We keep track of who was the last to text, who was the last one to call or to visit. We're tempted to keep track of favors that are done, invitations that are offered. And we use that in sometimes unhealthy ways as well. With all this in mind, should it be so surprising that we keep a scorecard with our relationship with the Lord as well? I'm not talking about just counting your blessings. I'm talking about works righteousness. I'm talking about keeping track of our good deeds in a way that eventually we'll feel that God somehow owes us something. Or perhaps we give unspoken point value to good deeds, which in our mind could cancel out sins with similar point values. So perhaps, you know, viewing online worship one Sunday, maybe that will delete those unkind words that I said to my children. Or maybe sending in some extra offering will make up for that spending spree that I went on getting things I didn't really need. And there's always a bit of hope with that, with this kind of thinking, that somehow we can build up some capital in God's bank, capital which we can draw on when we get into a pickle. You know, God's got to answer my prayer now, after all I've done for God, we might sometimes feel. If you've ever tried to keep score in your relationship with God, don't feel too bad, because, you know, people have done that throughout history. But when we are in tune with our faith, the Lord will gently remind us that's not how it works. When we come to God in prayer, we come with nothing but a hungry spirit. We come as wounded souls in need of healing. We come naked and vulnerable before the Almighty. We come humbly asking for mercy. We humbly ask because we realize that God does not owe us anything, but we owe God everything. God has created and called and empowered each of us through the work of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. So the good news to embrace today is this: though we often are a scorekeeping people, God is not a scorekeeping God. That's our good news. David prayed it this way in the Psalms: "Have mercy upon me, O God, because of your unfailing love. Because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spark within me, a right spirit. Do not banish me from your presence. Don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me again the joy of your salvation and make me willing to obey you." Well, thankfully, again, we do not worship a scorekeeping God. When we sincerely confess our sins and our need for forgiveness, God wipes the scorecard clean of all of our sins. But until we allow God to do that, we'll always be behind. Our sins will outweigh our good deeds. And until we can freely turn them over to the Lord, we'll carry them around as a huge burden that'll just weigh us down.
and keep us from living that life that God desires for us, a life of joy, life of generosity, life of love. Peter's preaching to the Israelites speaks to us as well. Turn from your sins, he said, and turn to God so that you can be cleansed of your sins. Then wonderful times of refreshment will come from the presence of the Lord, and he will send Jesus, your Messiah, to you again. Well, keeping score may be fun in baseball or other games, but it can severely diminish good friendships. It can poison other relationships and keep us separated from God because of either prideful self-justification or hopeless feelings of unworthiness. And so instead, my friends, let us come before the Lord with a sense of joy and celebration as we allow God to erase our record of pride and sin and replace it with the gift of eternal love and forgiveness. As God's word in the Bible reminds us all, I will remember their sins no more, from Hebrews 8:12. All praise be to our patient and our generous and our forgiving God. Amen. My friends, I invite you, if you've not already done so, to make plans to contribute an offering from the fruits of your labor, whether you mail that in with a check or use our e-giving. We thank you for that. And I lift up those gifts now. Lord, we pray that you bless those intentionally generous gifts. Bless them with meaning. Bless them with effectiveness for the work of the church through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Tired of waiting, read all you can pray. Now times are wasting, there's nothing left to say. Leave me so, I've been there before. It's not always easy to be waiting on the Lord, but no.
Make all things new.
Friends, thank you for worshiping with us today. And we do pray that that this was a time of blessing for you in many different ways. Many thanks to all of our worship participants, to Cheryl Todd and to the Reborn musicians and singers, and to our liturgist, Terry Jesse, for being a wonderful host, for putting all this together as well. And again, thank you for participating and for worshiping with us. And so as we prepare to leave this time of worship, and we do so with the peace of Christ this day and forevermore. Amen.